Good morning. Thank you so much for coming up to celebrate the life of Richard Hap Arnold. I know the cry room's over there, but I can't go over there, so I gotta run this. So, yeah. But thank you for coming out here to Lancaster. Some of you guys haven't been here in many years. Some of you guys have never been here. Welcome to the heat that we have up here, 102, 103 today. So thank you for the journey that you guys had. Thank you so much for being a part of Hap's life. And obviously, if you were part of Hap's life, you're definitely part of mine. So after we're finished, there's going to be a nice taco bar outside, and we'll meet just in the side rooms over here. And for some of you, we're going to share some different stories up here, but some of you I'd like you to share in that room over there as well. So if you don't get the opportunity to share in here, we'll have the opportunity over there as well. So this has been tough. The tough thing is June 23rd. When we got the news about Hap, and tougher even for the last 2 months of knowing that you have to officiate a funeral and a celebration of life, and your thoughts are changing daily, as some of you guys were. We talked, and some of you guys that I asked to share some words, you've changed it a couple times, and so it just kind of goes on. But we're going to open a word of prayer with Pastor Jim Clark. You guys remember Jim?
Old roommate of mine.
I can't look at Ray. Let's pray. Almighty and everlasting God, we pause now humbly and reverently before you to give thanks to our dear friend, our brother, our mentor, Richard Hap Arnold. We commend his soul to you with certainty that he is now with you. We ask that you remove the sting of Hap's death from our hearts and minds today. Bring comfort to our grieving through our knowing that to be absent here with us is to be present with you. We pray that you will keep Hap's memory never far from our thoughts. And as we seek to emulate the characteristics and actions of the life of this great man, you will look with favor upon us and help us along our journey. In your name we pray. Amen.
Richard Hap Nelson Arnold. He was born October 8th, 1939. He went home to be with Jesus June 23rd, 2022. He was a graduate from Point Loma High School in 1957, state junior master counselor in 1957-58 for DeMolay. In high school, he was the president of the Bible Club. He was an officer of the ROTC. He was on the fancy military drill team. Hap was. And he was a mathematics man. He went on to college at San Diego State and got his degree in biochemistry, I believe. Chemistry, I know that. He worked as a lab technician for California Youth Authority and so many different hospitals. I tell you, when he first met and I went down there, he invited me to lunch and going to the youth authority and everything else. You walked into his office, and he knew how to deal with people, So you had the California's finest that went to the youth authority over there, and they'd be some big old boys and really tough and everything else. And he says, well, here's how I take care of those guys, He reaches in his drawer and pulls out a syringe about this big. And he says, well, here, let me take your blood. And they just look at him like this, So half sense of humor even went into his work days. But he worked at as a lab technician for all these years for one purpose, to invest in each and every one of us. You know, I thought about a lot of things that I was going to say today in his eulogy. But one thing I just have to say, let's look at his overall life. He was our dad. You know, thinking about his eulogy for the last couple of months, so many memories came through my heart. And I've only met two or three individuals that have touched so many thousands of people's lives the way he did. And two of them are passed away now, Hap and Russ Mandel. However, in the organization that we belonged to, we had many advisors and many dads that guided us through so many different things throughout our life. And they touched our hearts just as much. I mean, there are some individuals, and when you mentioned Hap, you had to mention Don Moeller, his sidekick. They were always together. And so we were really blessed to have Hap really share with us his life and everyone in such a different way. I'm not going to be able to tell you anything that you don't already know. And so that's why I'm going to do the eulogy a little different, because everyone here today is going to have an opportunity to share how Hap touched your life. And again, whether you do it right in here or we do it over in an informal setting, I would like everybody to have the opportunity to share while we're having some incredible tacos over there. And so, you know, put your thoughts together and share. And it doesn't matter when you say, hey, I just want to say something, just stand up over there and say it. We're going to have some people share here in a few moments. However, I invite, again, each of you to, don't think you're being left out here, but we're going to have an opportunity over there as well. You know, when we think about Hap, you got to think about his sense of humor. As bad as it was, the Hap jokes. And we joked about them all the time, but we repeat many of them. I'm going to share a lot of the key items in my words. I only put a couple words together. So there's not enough pages that can fill the memories of Hap. So we're going to open this time for the real eulogy of what each and every one of you have. And there's no particular order that I have, but I'd like to invite Dennis up here. Dennis was his son. And Dennis will share a little bit there, and I'll share some things about Dennis too. So, Dennis, if you will.
Hi, I'm Dennis. I'm pretty sure a lot of you know I'm Hapson. Not really good at this. I didn't know where to start. I didn't know where to finish. I really don't know. I'm not there yet, so I'm sorry. I'm really not there yet. Mentally, emotionally, I can't talk about him. Only been to his house a couple times just to look for things, but I really can't go to his house. Drive by there, but I'm sorry. When I have time, I'll do. Thank you, Don, for coming. Don Mahler, Don Stevens. He was, you know how much he meant to you. I can't talk right at the moment, but thank you, everybody, for coming in. Thank you so much. If you're here, I really appreciate it. Thank you. I get this to somebody later.
Dennis, if you don't mind, I'm going to share something you shared with me. Is that all right? Dennis shared with me on two occasions of how much Hap really meant to him. And I understand, I've talked to Dennis a couple times, and more times than not, he didn't take my call because he didn't want to talk about some things. And I understand that. Well, Dennis shared with me how grateful he was to Hap, his dad. Remember the day that Hap came in, sat down with Jennifer and I. He was 65, 66 years old. Huh? Oh, 61, so he's a young man at that time. He was 61 years old. So he came in and said, hey, I want to have a family like you have. And he says, I want to go adopt a boy over in the Ukraine. And he talked to Don and a couple of others. And he went over there and he was going to adopt one boy. And the organization says, well, we don't normally separate family members, so there's two. And Hap was in awe, like, I came for one. And he came home with two. And I'm so grateful that he came home with the second one. As Dennis shared with me, he owes Hap his life. Dennis was adopted from the Ukraine. And he shared with me just the other day of Hap giving me an opportunity to live life. You look at what's going on in the Ukraine right now, as he said, I'd be fighting in a war right now or I'd be dead. And Hap is really taking care of him. Hap loved to travel, you guys know that. And he looked forward to doing homeschooling and taking these guys on the road and traveling during his retirement. That lasted for a little while until he says, hey, I don't know about this homeschooling thing. You know? But Hap loved these two boys a great deal. And you guys know he gave everything to them. What some people don't know about Dennis is Dennis had a job and Dennis was going to college down in La Mirada, Orange County area, where Hap used to live. He was staying at the house down there in his apartment and stuff. And Hap started turning his health. And he called Dennis and asked him if he can come up and help him. Dennis, without any hesitation, walked away from what he had. And Dennis, I'm so appreciative to you being there for your dad and my dad. Thank you. I know it's tough. He loved you, and you know that. He laid his life on the line for you, and you did the same for him. You were there for him when he needed you. Take that to heart. You carry on Hap's legacy. You're loved, and you still have family. Okay? I love you. We're going to speak or have Don Mueller, his best friend of all time, between him and Gary Young, I think those three were just inseparable. So a good friend of mine, Dad Don Mueller.
I know Hap is up there looking down today and seeing all of you, and he's so proud because you all meant something special to him, and I know that you're here because he meant something special to you. Over the last several weeks, I've been giving a great deal of thought to our association and the times we spent together. If you will bear with me, I just want to share a few of them. There were so many. And I know others will also be sharing similar good times later today. I first met Hap at a Citrus D-Malay League meeting in Duarte in the mid-1960s. I was in my early 20s, just raised as a Master Mason, and then serving as a chapter and league advisor. Hap had met and been invited to the meeting by a D-Malay named Rick Hall, who later would become a jurisdiction master counselor. Richard had recently moved from San Diego, where he was working for the phone company at that time and living at home with his parents, Tom and Gladys Arnold. He was asked to come and work for the jurisdiction, then headquartered in Glendale. He also worked part-time as a lab tech at the Burbank Community Hospital, which soon thereafter turned into a full-time position. But he continued to volunteer his time to the jurisdiction office and travel around for D-Malay. A lifetime friendship between Hap and I began that evening in Duarte. I remember a short time afterwards, Hap inviting me as his guest to go to the Playboy Club located in Hollywood. You know, it was somewhat of a status symbol at that time to possess a Playboy key. And for me, a somewhat shy and introverted person, quite an eye-opening experience. Great food, drinks, various types of great entertainment, and of course, those adorable, cute bunnies. I'm not talking about the animal here. It was one of the several that we had the opportunity to visit in our travels. Shortly after I became a Master Mason, I was approached by a past master named Don Johansson of my lodge, who asked me to meet and listen as a favor to him to some of the concerns of the Master Counselor of Highland Park D-Malay Chapter. That was my introduction to Gary Young. And I mentioned that meeting to Hap, who paid the chapter a visit, joined its advisory council, and helped resolve some of the advisor-D-Malay relationship problems. Over time, Gary and his mom, Agnes, became close friends to both Hap and me. A close bond developed, and many good times, trips, D-Malay and Masonic experiences and involvements, and just fun occasions with friends and family were enjoyed. We were all there for each other at the passing of our parents, and when Katie married Katie Rowe, Hap served as his best man. Hap had joined Frank S. Land Masonic Lodge number 819, a new lodge with a roster of senior D-Malays, advisors, and D-Malay supporters. I affiliated with the lodge, and Gary received his degrees in Frank S. Land. While Hap was serving as junior warden, he formulated the idea of having an all-senior D-Malay line of officers. With some discussion and persuasion, it became a reality in 1973, with Hap serving as master, I as senior warden, and Gary as junior warden. Hap's love for DeMolay never wavered from the time he became an active DeMolay. Equally in his heart was his devotion to our Masonic fraternity, even serving again as master and then secretary of Tehachapi Lodge when he moved to Bear Valley Springs. You know, there's just a flood of memories of trips we made together, the jurisdiction for a trip to England, for instance, and visiting the site where Jacques DeMolay was burned at the stake. I, Gary, and Hap made a tour, I remember, to the East Coast a year before the bicentennial celebration to visit the battlefields, historic sites, see Washington, D.C., and all. And it was a great time, even though sometimes along the road we weren't feeling any pain. There were trips with jurisdiction officers to Grand Lodge, a memorable one with Ray Cacker, and maybe he can talk about that later, and several travels to out-of-state jurisdiction conclaves. There were also many ISC trips with which we added a little mini vacation to, and we also added some, took some along with us, some DeMolay advisors. I recall my first travel experience with Hap when in 1969, he and I traveled by train to the 50th anniversary of DeMolay in Kansas City. Gary had dropped us off at Union Station and then rushed to a friend's home in Highland Park whose backyard bordered the tracks, and where he and his mom and several chapter members and advisors were out there waving to us as we rushed by on the train. Another vivid memory was the 1980 ISC session with a pre-stopover in Kansas City. The traveling group included the jurisdiction dad, Russ Mandel, and the three jurisdiction officers, Ted Nicholas, Tom Nelson, and Todd McKinney. After we arrived, the JOs left to spend some time at a farm of one of the relatives of the JOs, while Hap and I spent time working at DeMolay headquarters, which was then located on the fifth floor of the Phillips Petroleum building at 201 East Armour in Kansas City, the original DeMolay headquarters. It was a thrill for me to meet some of the staff, Richard Harkins, who was the executive director, Tom Moberly, who was working in the office at that time, the receptionist Doris, and of course the Sarge. Hap knew all of them from his time serving on staff at various regional leadership camps. We had a great time and really enjoyed the company of the Sarge and his wife. After the group got back together, I remember being extremely nervous on our flight to Indianapolis as we flew through a horrendous thunderstorm, landing as the plane was swaying from side to side. And Hap all the time was just sitting there looking out the window nonchalantly, and I was a nervous wreck. Of course, the most memorable event, which made Hap very proud, was our SCJMC being elected IMC, the International Master Counselor. Of course, there were many other ISC trips that Hap and I, and then later Russ Mandel and Lance Braun would take. One of the last was the trip to Buffalo with a stop in New York City to tour its famous sites. And that was just after the horrendous terrorist action that took place on the Twin Towers. Hap informed us that he might receive a call that the paperwork had been completed, signed, and approved for him to go and pick up his adopted boy from the Ukraine. That call was received on the day before we were to depart by train to Buffalo. Hap left that next morning, and some 3 weeks later or so, came back with two boys, Dennis and Yuri, or later known as Thomas. Hap had many qualities. He was well-read and educated, loved to go to the movies, got me hooked on James Bond at a double feature of Dr. No and From Russia with Love, He was always considerate, thoughtful, affectionate, and although he could be tight-fisted with money, he would not hesitate to buy suit or clothes for any of our DMLAs when they needed but could not afford them. He also gave a couple of our DMLAs a place to stay. You can also say that he had a good sense of humor, sometimes with more groans than laughs. But overall, what I choose to remember of Hap are the good times, the shared friendships, and shared experiences we had together. DMLA, Freemasonry, family and friends were very important to Hap. I miss those good times, but know that we will all be together in the house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. Thank you.
I might need those. Yeah, there was and some of you guys know some of the trips that we did take with Dad Arnold, Hap, all across the state into other states as DMLAs. And I was fortunate enough to speak at some major, major events, Grand Lodge, Grand Bethel, Grand Assembly. Grand Assembly and Grand Bethel, they split it up. There was just a known thing that, whoever's in NorCal gets to speak there, Southern Cal speaks here, and pulled some strings, so I got to speak at both those during those years, so it was really great, especially with my sister being in Rainbow up in San Jose up there that we got to share with that. Grand Lodge, the Shrine, I forget what they called their convention, but I got to speak in front of all those guys, and no, how many times did we go over speeches and teach me to talk and everything else? So I thank you so much, Don and Hap, for doing all that and growing me in that aspect. I will look at that, say, hey, DMLA, where what it's done for my life is molded me in a certain way where I can even do something like this today. So. Next, we're going to have another great, all of us are great friends, so Gary Cherno, if you'd like to come up and share a memory or two or five. And after that, we're going to have the great friend of mine, Todd McKinney, come up, so give you a pre-order.
Morning. You know, when I heard about Hap and his passing, it just brings a lot of memories and of what we've all gone through, everybody. We've known each other for over 40 years. When I became a league officer and had to go to this new building we called the Dream, Hap at the time was the jurisdiction dad. And he was very formal, and you knew him as Dad Arnold, and you showed respect for the man. But once you got to know him, got a little different. He didn't turn out to be Dad Arnold. He was Hap. He was your friend. And instead of being an advisor, he was more of a brother, because we were not all saints in the organization, and we learned that from Hap. You would be at different functions, and if they were formal or non-formal, especially if you got to sit next to Hap and he was right next to you, he sat there very stern and, solid look on his face and all that. But the comments that came out of him that we could hear, you tried not to laugh, and he would just look over at you with this grin, which kind of reminded me of the Grinch. And Hap would just kind of look at you and, just give you this grinchy look. And we would all be laughing, and we'd be looked at. And Hap would be just, so that's what we learned from. And The one thing that I do remember, those of us that are old enough that went to Conclave, I know it was Ray's first, I believe it was what, 79, 80? 78. Some of our past jurisdiction officers were carrying hap. It was Saturday night, and we had a big dinner outside near a pool. We were at Francisco Torres up in Santa Barbara. And there was four guys, two carrying, one on each arm and one on each leg, carrying them in. And we were just kind of like, what's going on? You know, and they were, you know, we finally realized they were going to throw them into the pool. And they, you know, lined them up, ready to throw them in head first in the pool. And they counted one, two. They never got to three because the guys in front let them go and the guys in back didn't. So Hap kind of went like that. And I don't believe he did go in the pool, but he did hurt his back. And, you know, but he just laughed about it. It was just, you know, everybody, there was like 1,000 people there, just silenced. Couldn't believe what this, you know, what just happened. But, you know, Hap was always there to support us. And you know, that was one side of Hap you saw. The other side of Hap that I was lucky to know is I'm a member of the Cacker family. I'm Uncle Gary. And Hap was Grandpa. And on the holidays and stuff, we got to, we would go to Ray's house and visit with the girls and, you know, and get to celebrate the holidays there. And the meeting that Hap was asking, you know, Ray and Jennifer about you guys, Dennis, I happened to have been at, it was Christmas, I believe Christmas Eve, and I was sitting there too, because I remember Hap was on a chair across the room, and I was on the couch with the girls, and Ray and Jennifer was on this other couch, and he mentioned you guys. And, you know, we just kind of like, you know, was shocked. And but he was glowing. You know, he was really glowing when he talked about you guys, and it was real special. And you can see what Hap was, you know, going through and saying and stuff, and it was a great thing what he did. You know, so I'm glad to see you. It's been years since I've seen you, but I just want you to know also that he was just, you know, just shining when he talked about you guys. And the other thing I got to see is when he got to deal with his granddaughters. All five of them. Sorry. Ray jokes around that he wanted a boy, but he has it with his grandchildren. So, but anyway, he was very proud, and he was very honored to be a grandfather to the five girls. And, you know, just the crazy things that we would do. We would go to a restaurant. We went one time to Garden Grove, and, you know, he sat there and tried to lasso all five of the kids. You know, but he was... Besides being with DeMolay, he was a great family man. And like I say, he just joked all the time. But the one time that I saw really the serious side of him, we brought up Russ Mandel. And Russ Mandel was very special to all of us. And on Russ's last days, he was at LA County General. And Hap and Don Muller and myself and Robert Sturdivant were up in this ward. It was an infectious disease ward. And there was nobody around. And it was just touching that, you know, seeing Russ the way he was. He couldn't talk, and he was just laying there. And I know that Don, myself, and Hap went into the room. Robert was already in there. And we had to walk out because it just bothered us. And the first time I ever saw Hap as serious as he was, and that side of Hap was just incredible. But, you know, in the years that I've known him, like I say, he started out as an advisor, and he ended up being a family, my family. And I thank you all for being here, and thank you.
I should have helped my elders down. Sorry. Exactly. Todd McKinney, would you like to come up and share? He said, please. Dressed like DeMolay, huh?
Absolutely.
Remember the first time Todd and Tim and everybody else wore that tuxedo with the tennis shoes when, you know, the great times.
We've had all had great times with Hap. He brought light to DMLA, especially if you're a jurisdictional officer and we were, you know, sometimes in the mix of stuff, and sometimes Dad Kelly was a little strict on us. And Hap was always that guy that, you know, kind of gave you a hug and kind of kept you going with a smile and maybe lighter advice. And I needed a lot of that when I was a jurisdiction officer, because I tended to get in trouble a little bit because, you know, I wasn't the deputy. I wasn't the master counselor. I was just the Congress secretary, so I got away with shit. And needless to say, I got to go see Dad Nahan in his office building down at the B of A building in L.A. to get legal papers drawn up with, you know, different things. But Hap was always that guiding light that went with us on travel, kept us safe, kept us with a smile on our face, and gave us love. I know he's in heaven looking at us, enjoying that we're here, and enjoying the memories as we all are. Thank you all for coming. Thanks, Ray.
Stacy Parr, would you please come up and share?
If you had heels on, he would help you too. So I am Stacy Parr Schmidt.
That's what I meant.
Yeah, that's
Stacy
okay.
Stacy Parr Schmidt.
That's
please
okay.
Come up and.
And I was one of Hap's princesses back in 1979. So he was one of my first DMLA dads. I've had a lot of amazing DMLA dads, but Hap was the first one that I really connected with, besides Dad Spaulding, who was my league dad, just because Hap was always there. He was an amazing, incredible man. His life was a gift to everybody that knew him. He was always there for his kids. I always knew that his door was always opened. Back then, there were no cell phones, so if I wanted to see him, I would just drive over. And he was always there. It was like he knew I needed him. He knew I was coming. He had snacks. He would just let me be. As a jurisdiction officer, we're always on. We're always happy and smiling, and sometimes you just needed to not do that and be yourself. And at Haps, you could. He'd give you great advice. I never got in trouble, so I didn't have that kind of advice from him.
Please.
But he gave great advice. He gave amazing hugs. He always had snacks. His house felt like my house. I could walk into it, make myself at home, and just hang out. Sorry. He was special, he was kind, he was loving, he was funny, he was always there, he was supportive, he was a role model, he was a mentor. He was what I wanted the dad for my kids to be. Somebody that listened to us, somebody that was there at every event we went to. And I'm blessed to have known him. And Hap loved. He loved everybody. I don't think there was anybody he ever turned away. I don't think there was anybody that he ever didn't listen to. And even though I'm an adult, he's still my dad. And I'm still his kid. I'm grateful to have known and loved Hap. One of my favorite lines from a song sums up how I feel about Hap. And those that know me well, I'm not gonna sing it. Gary Cherno. Because I knew you, I have been changed for good. And because I knew Hap, I was changed for good. I knew how to be a better person. I knew how to talk to people. I knew how to make everybody feel hopefully important, because that's how Hap made us feel. Even though there could be 20 people, he always focused on everyone individually. I read part of this poem at my dad's funeral, and it brings me comfort thinking of Hap, knowing that he's waiting for us. Death is nothing at all. I have only slipped away into the next room. Nothing has happened. Everything remains exactly as it was. I am I, and you are you. And the old life that we lived so fondly together is untouched and unchanged. Whatever we were to each other, that we are still. Laugh as we always laughed at the little jokes that we enjoyed together. Play, smile, think of me, pray for me. Life means all that it ever meant. I am but waiting for you for an interval somewhere very near, just around the corner. And I know Hap is waiting for us just around the corner. So Hap, until we meet again, I will be missing you, your love for your life, and your love for us kids. Thank you.
Here, let me help you. I can see everybody else move too, so. A good friend of mine, Mike Cosling, if you care to come up and share something. Mike and I and Jim and Alan Meek were roommates with Hap, and
we were the training with that young man down there in his brother.
Yep.
That's
yep.
when he probably was convinced that he could handle the job by dealing with us for. Oh, man. Such a big influence. I got to meet him when I was about 15. I joined DMLA in 74 in a small place called Linwood back then. And our chapter had just gone through this major upheaval. Most of the teenagers that were leading the chapter all up and left because they didn't like the advisors. So when I had just joined less than 6 months, I managed to find my way into a chair that had a purple robe and became master counselor at like 15 and barely knew what the heck I was doing in that room, let alone, you know, getting experience of watching others kind of go through those chairs and doing the degree work and just experiencing DMLA. Most of us have enjoyed for all the years that we were together and still kind of share, mostly via Facebook, which is how we all kind of reach out and touch each other still, which has been a godsend as far as I'm concerned. It's made it great for all of us. But I kind of tap into where Don was going. I mean, I managed to either be lucky or fortunate to get picked up by Don, Gary, and Hap, who must have saw something in me, or I must have saw something in them, but I kind of gravitated towards those three, and they kind of provided me the wherewithal to become the leader I became in DMLA. And then the small token of appreciation for what they did for me, you know, I stuck around, became an advisor, I joined Frank S. Land Lodge. They actually tried to groom me into going through the chairs, and at some point I had to make a decision, and I went to school and kind of gave up that crazy road to going through the chairs and lodge, so I've got some work to do still, you know, in that realm of my life, and maybe that'll come soon, but definitely enjoyed working with Hap for all the years that we were all together. He taught me how to make stencils and run mimeograph machines. I can remember many nights in his garage putting together all of our programs and our directories and our leadership camp materials. And I mean, there's no shortage of opportunities to get dirty and learn new things, you know, with Hap. I mean, he was just that kind of guy. And as was noted before, it wasn't really a hard, stern relationship. It was more of a friendship, but you had that respect for him being the elder and the person that was leading you around. But he made it more of a joy to get that advice and learn through doing and practicing some of the things that he believed in deeply as we went through that DMLA experience together that I still take with me, even in my current position at work today. I was fortunate to work in aerospace for my whole career, worked on some pretty cool things, rockets and spacecraft and airplanes and unmanned space stuff. So I take a lot of the lessons that got me into those positions to lead those kinds of programs and lead people in my professional life, and I bring that back to the three people that started back when I was a teenager, and Hap being a big influence. I don't know what was wrong with this guy, because he decided to take me in and live with him for about 5 or 6 years as I was working my way through school. And I definitely appreciate those years together. It definitely made my life possible to get through school, get my college degree, and finally take off and start my life. And all the memories, I mean, there are tons of memories. I mean, Don brought up a few of those that I definitely can connect with, the jurisdiction trip over to Paris and London, and those are some of the best times that kind of came rushing back to me when I got the phone call a couple months ago, that for whatever reason, Hap had this way of really delivering rededication ceremonies wherever there was an opportunity to get a bunch of us together and kind of bring back what the meaning of the organization was and how we applied the lessons and how we meant, what we meant to each other. And so that was kind of one of the first memories that come rushing back to me, was standing there in Paris next to that river and him delivering that rededication ceremony at the site of that person that meant so much to all of us. That's the namesake of our organization that we all are connected through. So it's those memories will never stop. I mean, there's plenty of things I'll get to remember time and time again, and it's been fun to kind of share some of those memories and some of the pictures I dug out from when I heard that. And one of the things, I was fortunate, he was in my wedding party with my wife Patty, and I put that picture back up there today, and kind of as a tribute to him. But those people were big influences. Some of these guys are still around that were part of that party, and it's nice to know we can still touch each other and get together and speak to each other, and we just need to value those times that we still have together and are able to reach out and touch. Because like Stacy said, that day's coming, we'll all get together again in a different place behind a different door, but while we're here together, we should make sure that we take the time to enjoy each other's company and reflect on those great times that we all had as teenagers growing up together, as young adults that were still kind of connected and trying to find our way and moving into the next phases of our own individual lives as with our families and the next things that we grasped onto that we developed into our what ended up being our lives as we know it today. So I thank you very much for the opportunity to get up here and talk with all of you. It's been great to see these faces again, and I look forward to spending a little bit more time with you guys today. Thanks.
Sorry, Stacy. when Mike was sharing a couple things there, I was reflecting on how many times we were in that room in the garage making those leadership manuals and everything else. And what came to me was the fact that all the leadership manuals and everything else, there was a couple people in his influence that they wrote all that stuff. These weren't manuals that they would just go buy and say, hey, let's adapt them to this. They wrote all that stuff and passed it on to us. And I look at the careers that many of us have, absolutely amazing from a youth organization like this. And we have judges and lawyers and engineers and guys that have worked on things that we don't even know that was out there. We have school teachers. We have, just moms and dads and a group of people that just did so many different great things. I'm just amazed because the leadership qualities that Hap shared with us, we've taken them on beyond, and we're still using them today. So next we're going to have friend Jim Clark. Jim's a pastor down in Orange County there, big church, big church.
Thanks, Ray. I think we're transitioning generations now into the next decade a little bit there. When Ray asked me to share today, my heart kind of sank. Everybody in this room knows that this moment comes for each of us. But there are some people you just hope that tradition changes for. And that would be Hap. There have been some key men in my life. And some of you are here today. But Hap is certainly near the top five, top 10. Hap held the distinction of shaping me through the most formidable time in my life. Time when I didn't want to be taught by my own father for certain. Hap was a surrogate father to me, like Ray and Mike and so many others in this room. I do think it was a little odd. I was looking back at some memories, and somehow my parents seemed to know that Hap might be a better parent for me in many circumstances than they often were. And I'm really, really horrible with dates. So I went into the garage and I pulled out this huge box of memories. It's in the car today that I brought. And I started looking at things. And in that box was all my DMLA memories. And there were letters and certificates and a letter inviting me to be a DMLA, and blurry photos. We have much better photos today than we had then. Most of you have your eyes closed in many of the photos. I met Hap on July 30th, 1979. I know that date because that's the date I became a DMLA. I believe Don had somehow talked my dad into being an advisor. And Don and Hap were there the day that I was initiated. And I think Stacy confirmed, I think Hap was jurisdiction dad at that time. And I didn't even know what a jurisdiction dad was. I didn't know how important the role is. I've come to know that the job of the jurisdiction dad is to wrangle league officers together and try and keep them out of trouble as much as possible while prodding them to get in trouble at the same time. Even with that important role, Hap had time. He came to our house regularly for dinner. This is a story I still can't believe is true. In 1980, I pulled out the picture. Somebody paid for me to go to International DMLA Leadership Camp. My parents couldn't have afforded it. And my parents were not very communicative, so they said, fill a bag of clothes. Hap will be by to pick you up. And he came, and I think he had a little orange Datsun B210 that was really small. And he had loaded all of his equipment in the back of the car, and Brian Reynolds was already in the car, and we drove about 8 hours to La Honda, California, to leadership camp. And today I think it's kind of strange that somebody would just hand their son to another adult man and send him off for a week to a camp, and I really didn't know much that was going on there. Hap, I think, was my counselor there, one of my counselors. I'm pretty sure he was the camp leadership director. I know that I cut mimeograph and stencils for the newsletter every day. And at 13 years old, he decided that I should be the orator for the DMLA degree. I had very, very little even remembrance of my DMLA degree at that time. So in his spare time, he helped me learn two or three pages of dialogue from the rituals so that I could perform being an orator. And Hap and I would be connected from then on. He saw something in me that I didn't see in myself. and he guided me for the next 8 years of my life. In June of 1984, I graduated high school. Things were not good in my home. And after a night of partying with friends, I went home and gathered a bag of clothes and knocked at Hap's door and moved in, uninvited. But I moved in. There was a spare bed either in Ray's room or Mike's room. I think Mike and Alan shared a room, and there was an extra bed in Ray's room, so if there weren't dirty clothes on that bed, that's where I stayed, and if there were dirty clothes on it, I'd stay on the sofa. And I stayed there for about a year. Hap was the only person I shared with what was going on in our home. Sandy knows it all. No. I work about 2 minutes away from Springview and Singleton now. I drove by the house on my way home yesterday. I think I learned that I needed to keep my bed organized and my room clean from Hap. I vividly remember that we had to wash our bath towels after every use. I still don't know why we had to do that, but... And we don't do it today, but that was one of the things that I remember Hap teaching, is we always needed to have clean towels. Maybe we just didn't have enough towels for all of us. Hap was a calming place and a comfort. I'm sorry to Mike and Ray, but I don't think I ever paid a cent of rent for the entire year that I lived there, and I'm sure they did. Later that summer, at Hap's encouragement, and I was elected league president of Golden West League back in 1984. It's something that I look forward to and hoped for. And I don't know if Don was stepping down from that role then, but Hap agreed and stepped in and became our league administrator at that time, and I couldn't have been happier. And our installation was on September 29th. Of that day night, and it was a great night of celebration. And then Hap wasn't there. And he showed up late and said that he had been jurisdiction meetings, and he pulled me aside to tell me that I was out of a job, that the powers that be had just reorganized all of the jurisdiction and league, and Golden West League was over. And the next night, I had my first and last league meeting as president of Golden West League, and Hap made the announcement, and there were a lot of tears, and as I remember, there was some anger and frustration, probably on my part too, and Hap was a comfort then. Hap had a way with me of just kind of talking sternly when I needed it. He may have even slapped me on the back of the head, and I needed a lot of slapping on the back of the head that time. But somehow I trusted in that. As always was the case, his advice and wisdom was okay. He would continue to advise and bring me comfort and correcting me as president of Century League, and gave me my lifelong friend, Mike Hosling, to be my league dad as Hap started to step away a little bit. Even after I moved out, I think I came to Hap's house about once a month for a while. And like Stacy, you just knocked 11 o'clock at night, 12 o'clock at night, Hap came to the door and welcomed you in. My life path took me away from DMLA, but I would still see him ever so often. And it's hard to think about now, but 2009 was the last time that we saw each other. He gave me a hug, called me by name, walked up to me, gave me a hug, asked about my folks, wanted to know everything that had happened since the last time we'd saw each other.
he met Sandy for the first time, and I know she was overwhelmed. There were hundreds of us there. She met everybody. But he wanted to know her as well, and know about her, and know that we were good. We talked on the phone every once in a while since then, probably once a year. There was always a bad joke, but we always recognized each other's voice. Still a comfort, knowing that he was there. A voice of wisdom and comfort whenever it was needed. I know many of you feel the same way about him. I will miss him dearly.
It's so interesting that the amount of time and words that Hap had for us, when you called him on the phone, it was always a short phone call. He wanted to get off that phone real quick. He's not a phone guy, but when you're in person, he'll talk to you about anything. And, you know, I'll tell you what, we've spent many hours throughout my life talking about so many of you guys, if not all of you that I know here, some of the guys I don't know here. But, you know, so we have Jim, and so we're going to look at a celebration of life video real quick. And I'm going to invite one or two other people that want to come up and share just for 2 or 3 minutes, and then I'm going to my message here. So we can watch that video here.
Will you remember me?
great memories there. You guys have a lot of pictures out there that some of you posted just recently. It just brought back so many great memories. One memory I will share for Cam and Tammy, we, for years and years and years, I don't know how old we are, how many years I can use right now, but we've had Easter and Christmas Eves over at each other's houses for quite a few years, and Hap and he bring the boys over and everything else, and you know, we just had a great time. I want to take this time real quick as I looked at this video. First of all, for Hope Chapel Church, Pastor Sean Appleton. Pastor Sean and I have four grandchildren together. You know, so he's a very blessed man with the four grandchildren he has, and I'm even more blessed because of him being a pastor of this church and helping raise these four grandchildren and my daughter there. But so thank you to that, and thank you for his wife and the church for helping us get this together. My wife, my rock. You know, I'm a pastor of a church, and every week she types out all my notes, keeps me going, and this celebration life was no different. Making the programs and getting everything together. And then Sarah, with the video there that Jennifer and her put together, your effort was just incredible. Your love for your grandpa was always there. You know, so thank you to my family. You know, you guys were loved by Hap, Grandpa, as you called him. I'm going to open up just for a couple individuals here. I know there's a member or two from the lodge that would probably like to say something. And again, we're going to have time over here. So if we can just have one or two people come up and share briefly, 2 to 3 minutes there.
Old knees. I'm Chris from Tehachapi, the Master Lodge 313, and I have not known Hap as long as everyone has. It's been about 6 years. Now, I'm Hap's neighbor also, but where are my emails, Hap? My weekly smiles, and, you know, I he sends out jokes. I don't know if they were particularly categorized by the type of individuals he was sending them to, because some of them could be a little earthy, and some of them could be a little dry. But when I'm feeling low, I just think of those emails coming to lift my day. The second thing I'd like to mention too, being Hap's neighbor, I had to, when Dennis wasn't around, I would take Hap to his appointments. There was never a word of discouragement, of bitterness. It was all, okay, Chris, okay, can I pay you for taking me? Hap, no, well, we need to go to lunch. No, I mean, you know, and we've got his oxygen there, and his transformation to that lodge not made with human hands. There was no bitterness. I mean, what a leadership example that was. And Dennis is not here right now, but the other leadership lead by example, Hap was a secretary when I was there, but that was not the leadership I saw. That was not what he exhumed. He and Dennis would prepare the meal for the stated meeting, and the Eastern Star ladies would be there trying to help. Well, Dennis is the type that's got to have sweat on his brow, right? He's got to work, so don't get in his way. But I've never seen a dad's pride and smile, which will embed in my mind and heart, when Hap would watch Dennis working there. Just that visual dad, son, and obviously the love and that burst through with the pride that he had in working with him and in preparing a meal for his brothers and sisters. So that's what he brought to the lodge. So we have members that are a lot older than me that have similar stories. And so thank you for the celebration of life, because that's what HAP was all about.
All right.
Anybody else want to share for a minute?
Good afternoon. Before I start, so Hap has inspired me, his spirit and his soul has pushed me up here, and a lot of his mischievousness have gotten me to come up here. If you don't know who I am, I'll say this for starters. It's taken 47 years and a drive all the way out to the desert to see Mike Cosling from Linwood, California, my first line signer when I joined DeMolay. And who would think there'd be two Linwood DeMolay at this event today? That's amazing. I'm Zachary Hahn. I was a master counselor, didn't league president, but Hap was the greatest advisor. And I'll tell you, I waited for Don Moeller to say something about this, and he didn't bring it up. I listened to Gary Chernow, and he did kind of get close to the mischievousness of Hap, but he didn't get to it. Todd didn't say anything, Stacy, Jim. So, Gary, we were at Santa Barbara at that event, that place that had the pool, and Hap had been, well, I'd seen the year before that they had the Grand Exalted Order of the Black Toe, and so the first year I was there, I was young, and I was afraid, but the next year I said, I've got courage, Hap wants me to join the Grand Exalted Order of the Black Toe, so we go into some dark room. You get this robe partially on the top half. On the bottom half, you roll up a pant leg. You get a rope towed around your waist with the other people with courage. They take a black Sharpie and color your large toe with a black marking all over your toenail. Just your toenail's blackened. You're blindfolded, and then you're marched around a lot of things, including Saturday night when everyone's lined up for the dinner. You have to get marched around the pool. Rather embarrassing, but once a member of the Great Order of Black Toe, and Hap, I wish Don could tell me more. I don't have the greatest memory about this, but I know a lot of adults frowned on this, but this was the kind of mischievousness that Hap Arnold, and I'll never forget that I'm a living member of the Grand Exalted Order of the Black Toe. Thank you for your time.
He came up and said, hey, I got here late. Did you already talked about the black toe? There's some things you just choose to forget. You know? Well, thank you so much. Can I just say I've got some great friends here? As you can tell by the stories we heard, and we'll hear in a little while, they all have common traits. He loved each and every one of you for who you were. Each one of us called him dad, brother. I said this before, but we talked a lot about every one of you. the stories that he shared with me and the stories I shared with him stayed between the two of us. But he really loved you. He'd call you by names. And this is years and years later. It brought joy to him of you being in their life because you were such a blessing to him. Our relationship started about 45 years ago when I was 15 years old as well. And I look at all these things that we did when we were 15 and 16 years old, 17 to 21 on the youth organization. My daughters asked my wife if they can run over to the store, which is just across the street. And she says, no, I'm going to go with you. Dad will take you to the mall. You're not going by yourself yet. We drove and drove and drove all across Southern California when we just got our driver's license. For some of us up here, Todd McKinney up in Wolford Heights at the time, Ridgecrest, they would make that trek down to the tip of Southern California, San Diego down there. We would travel all over Southern California on a weekend. We'd be in San Diego on a Friday night somehow. We'd been in Santa Maria Saturday and back to Palm Springs on Sunday. Go to school Monday through Friday and do it all over again. Mind you, this was out without cell phones. This was out without emails. And I was just going to say no GPS or MapQuest. Thomas Guides. Before that, we had some maps, you know. We got to use those Thomas Guides very well. Hap was kind of a central area in La Mirada. And I first met Dad Arnold, as you brought up, Gary, at Conclave. My very first year at Conclave, I joined again, just like some of you guys. I joined Lancaster chapter out here. And there, our chapter went like this before I was joining. I was 12 years old when I started, 11 when I started hanging out with my brother and all the other guys over here in DeMolay. And when I turned 13, I was looking forward to joining, and there was only about four or five guys that were still active in our chapter up here. And I have no idea how, but I was inspired to restart it up because I saw the goodness of what they were doing and everything else. And there was four or five of us sitting on the stairs, not having enough for a meeting or anything else. And I told these guys, hey, let's start inviting our friends and everything else. Lancaster chapter was the biggest growth chapter, according to Hap, in the history of DeMolay at that time. We brought a lot of different people in. Every year we won the membership award for bringing people in, not only in our chapter, but we also got kicked out of a league, Kern League. They said, Lancaster, we don't want you anymore. They redid some things, you know, just like Golden West and everything else. But we started this High Desert League. And again, I was the master counselor just less than a year after I joined DeMolay, junior counselor. And it was just quick, you know. And then the first time I went to Conclave, I fell in love with that. And I remember there was a song that night. There was a country western band, some of you guys will remember. Hap got in trouble for this band that was there for this particular song. I'm not going to say it, but you guys know what it was. And you had Dad Kelly as the executive officer, was stern. And I remember they had a meeting on that. And I think we had that band one other time. So it was a good time with that. But again, when you're counting, just remember 2.5, you know, at least let go, as Gary said. So 2.5 always counts on my mind of when Hap hurt his back there. the years that we had, again, during leadership camp and everything else, the knowledge Dad Arnold had to help us form into so many leaders as we are today is incredible. And I look out, we have a mayor of Palm Desert here, Indian Wells, sorry. That's kind of like me saying Lancaster and Palmdale. So, nope, you know. So forgive me not reading properly there, but Indian Wells, so a mayor here. I mean, the leadership qualities that he instilled in us go so deep into our lives. The knowledge Dad Arnold had, he wasn't afraid to share with any of us. And one day I was league president, I started to travel and meet you guys. And after a meeting, Hap said, hey, if you ever need a place to stay overnight or anything else, you can stay down here instead of driving back and forth. And you can imagine the miles that we put on up here. I know you guys were driving up here today going, how far is Lancaster? You know, you guys had a really nice, you went to a league meeting, you had a 5-minute drive to five or six different leagues. We had an hour and a half drive minimum each and every time. Todd had a little bit more. But he said, you know, I talked to him afterwards and said, well, I'm going to go to Cal State Long Beach. I got accepted down to Cal State Long Beach. I was going to be I wanted to be an engineer, but I didn't know what type of an engineer. I wanted to be an architect. Anyway, I changed my major a couple times because it was like, you know, there was something different that I think I need to do. And so I told him I was going to come down and ask him, hey, if you know anybody in the area that has a room to rent, if you would let me know. He said, why don't you come stay with me until you can find a place to live out here. 3-4 years later, I still couldn't find a place to live out there. But as his story would always say is when I went down there, again, before GPS or anything else, he says, you come down here in Imperial Highway, you go here, you know, and my house is right, you know, through this little street. Well, if you don't know that little corner right there, there's some major streets and there's these little small tiny streets and it's dark out and I drove by it and I drove back by and I kept driving by and ended up in Santa Gertrudis Boulevard or something like this at a Shell station I don't know if some of you guys remember payphones. You know, so I put my coins in and called him and says, hey, I know I'm close, but I don't know where I'm at. And he told me where I was. And he says, you're 3 minutes away. Found my way back to that same gas station and called him again. About 30 minutes later. So he said the biggest mistake I made was telling you how to get to my house from the Shell station to my house. He says, that changed my life, and I wish at times I wouldn't have told you, you know. So that was his sense of humor. Or was he serious? But found a place to stay, and you know, Hap's room was there. He gave me the keys, and we talked about rent. I paid. Not as much as Mike paid. Definitely not as much as Alan paid, but he charged me. He goes, why don't I just charge you $50 a month? Great. He says, until you find a place to stay. Well, every month I know I'd give him the $50, and we would go to dinner, and we'd go to a men's clothing shop, and he'd buy me a suit, he'd buy me dinner, he'd buy me, you know, and he goes, I guess that was a good $50 investment for you, huh? And I said, I'm not asking you to do this, and I'll talk about that in a second, about why, but eventually, I showed up. He gave me the keys. He left for work. He says, hey, in the backyard, I have a swimming pool if you want to use the pool. And you guys know his selection of videos and movies, VHSs back in the day. And he said, you want to walk and watch this? And so I thought, all right, I'll go in the backyard and check out the backyard and the pool. I'm not much of a a swimmer, but pool's there, what the heck, you know? So in his room, he had this paneling up aluminum foil on his windows, you know, so it was dark in his room. And so I trek out to his room. I open the sliding glass door, take a step, and I am on my nose into the water right there. The brightness off of the water and how bright it was that day, come from a dark room. I took a step, and I had no idea there was a step there. And his pool, if I'm serious, is that 3 feet even from his door? I mean, it's you're stepping out, take 2 steps, you're into the water. I didn't have to take those 2 steps. I crashed right into it. So I thought I'd look at that, and he came home and says, "Hey, what happened? You know, I got a little bruise here." And I told him. He says, "Yeah, I didn't tell you about this step, you know." So again, it was he was an advisor to each and every one of us. Dad Arnold taught me so much in a short amount of time. He taught us always. I should say he taught us not by his words, but by his actions. All the time, his actions. He was a man that, as jurisdiction master counselor, as I became, would, Todd, you definitely understand this, and jurisdiction officers understand this, he would let you make a mistake. He would let you trip, and he would let you fall, but you never hit the ground, except for that pool. He would protect you and guide you and say, "Hey, you blew it here, but here's how we're going to correct it." Writing our speeches and sharing everything else. While I was campaigning for office, and Don and Gary and some of you guys, others know this, they would sit in a chair wherever we were, and they would start counting. They would sit in their chairs and start rocking. And they told me they need to work on some things with me. As you're nervous and you get up to speak, I saw some of us kind of doing this. I'd always get up and start talking like this, and everybody else would start getting seasick. So he would start counting, because how many times I would say or, you know. So he would really help me out. Not that I don't say a lot. I have that in my mind of try to get your thought process together. He was very influenced on how you dressed and how you sat there. And there was a meme on Facebook that says, "Mention one person that you shouldn't be sitting with in a very formal event." Hap would be one of them, and every one of you would be another. We'd have that same sense of humor. And when I'm watching TV at home, I do the same thing with my family, and they don't think it's funny. We're watching Bachelorette, The Bachelor, Dancing with the Stars, all these. They need commentary. And when I do it at home, they grab that remote, pause it, look at me, and I said, "Hey, I learned it from the best guy, Hap." Hap would always have that commentary for those situations, and again, we would be laughing, and he would be sitting there all nice, Mr. Prim and Proper, because he was the jurisdiction dad who got us into trouble. When all eyes are upon us, His actions and his character spoke louder than his words. To be honest, when I moved down with him and he told me what he would do for me, I didn't believe him. You see, I grew up with 7 different stepdads. A lot of abuse, a lot of alcohol, a lot of very difficult times. Some of you guys definitely understand this. So here's a man that says, "Come and live with me for a while until you can find a place to move into." And he didn't push me out at all. But he told me he'd do these things, and I thought, yeah, right, why are you going to do this? I know how men act. Men speak and don't follow through with it, guys. And some of you guys, some guys out there, I should say. So he instilled into me what a man truly is and what a man can be. A man that honors what he says. A man that's going to be there for you no matter what. His actions always showed me that. He never looked at me as a poor guy from the Antelope Valley that was traveling and, you know, thought this would be a project, because the projects came after I moved in. The other guys, I'm teasing. We had some great times in that house. We learned a lot. We did a lot of different things. And he'd always joke with me about finding a place to live afterwards, that I guess you couldn't find a place to live that gave you food, clothing, shelter, cars, whatever you needed for $50 a month. I said, nor could I find it. He loved me even further after I got married. One of my best friends of all time, Mike Cosling, called me up. I was working at Northrop. I graduated Cal Lutheran University, played baseball over there on a full ride scholarship. Got a degree in engineering and had an incredible job as a cost estimator at Northrop. And I was somebody at Northrop. I was the guy, there were two of us that bid on all the stuff. Mike calls me one day and says, hey, you need a real job? I said, Mike, I got a real job, you know? And Mike was working at McDonnell Douglas. Mike is somebody I've always looked up to on his work ethics, his school ethics, and he got a lot of that stuff from Hap as well and was able to do that stuff because of Hap. And I looked up to him, and I said, well, let me go talk to my bosses and see. I didn't know anything about this, working for somebody and moving. And I talked to Hap, and he says, yeah, you need to do this. I called Mike up and said, yeah, I'd like to come work with you. I told Hap that I was going to work at McDonnell Douglas. And he says, well, my house is still available, and I got some rooms, and Jennifer and I moved in with a little baby, Christina, who he absolutely fell in love with. He took our rent up to $100. I was a good investment for him. I brought him five daughters and a beautiful wife, as he called his daughter. So he helped me become the man that I am today. He did what he said he would do. His honesty, his character, kindness, love is always going to be cherished in my heart. I'm going to share a message of hope with you. I know some of you guys watch me, and I'm honored that you watch me every Sunday on Facebook. I was assisting pastor here for 12 years or so, and I'm grateful for another man that directed my pathway into a solid Christian walk. Hap gave me a good foundation. My mom gave me a good foundation. Pastor Sean, again, opened his doors for us to do this today, and I'm grateful for that. So my message would be this. First of all, again, I thank each and every one of you for being here today. Hap had a way to bring us together many times. See, he still touches our life. He brought us together. Again, in Lancaster, thank you for the memories that each and every one of you shared, and and ask again that you would continue to share them while we're having a real good lunch. Lunch is provided by Heart Attack Barbecue, my brother's catering company. And I'm grateful for him. He loved Hap a great deal. So please, again, keep in mind that you can share over here. Some of you didn't want to come up here and share. But I ask each and of you to do this. Continue to make great memories, to serve God and your communities the way Hap did and the way he taught us to do it. So let's face it, we're not getting any younger. Live life. Call your family and friends. Enjoy time together. Not just at celebration of life events. Tell someone how you feel about them each and every day. Every time they come to your mind, don't be afraid to pick up the phone and call them. Instead of speaking at a memorial where he can't hear these words, nor can you at yours, that we would share with each other how we feel and how you impacted our lives. We've lost way too many individuals from our great, incredible group, our fraternity organization, starting with Ted Nicholas, Russ Mandel, Steve Farrell, Tracy Brown, Marv Thomas, Bruce Brown, Gary Young, then Hap, and just recently Mark Wilson and Rick Hyde. And I know there's so many that I didn't mention that had such a big impact on each and every one of us. But whether it be us or one of your family members or your own friends, the point is this: life's short. Yet the Word of God tells us life is long. I could not thank Hap enough for all and so many of you that have impacted my life. But my heart is this: I want to see each and every one of you, my friends, my family, in heaven one day, as God promises us eternal life. Well, I don't know everybody's actual religion or denomination. I do ask you to have an open heart about what I'm saying, and my heart is pure for this. Without a doubt, Hap, Dad Arnold, he is in heaven. It's because what the Bible says, he accepted this a long time ago. For John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have everlasting life. I know Hap accepted Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior. How could you have been a president of a Bible club in high school? As the story goes, if I will, look at those pictures. Mary Ross, some of you guys remember Mary Ross. I put a call out for all these pictures to be sent in because I know the cameras that we had were those Instamatic cameras that were always yellowish or orangish and stuff. And so I knew some of you guys had always had some nice cameras around. I put a call out for that. And Mary said, she called me and a Facebook man said, "Yo, my mom went to high school with him." I said, "Really?" She goes, I'm going to go through his yearbook and get some pictures. And some of those pictures that you saw there were from Mary's mom. And I appreciate that so much. And she shared a quick story. She said she had a convertible in 1957. And Hap rode in her, in her car. And she was going pretty fast and hit a bump or went over a hill. And Hap almost fell out of the vehicle. He's holding on while he's going out. She said that would be a cool memory to share. I thought, thank God he survived that. But he accepted Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior in his teenage years. He was the president of the Bible Club and went to church. He invited me to church many times in La Mirada when we were down there. He emulated Christ's love for each and every one of us. It is so simple for you to do as well, to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I've seen the characteristics of Christ in Hap for so many years. Hap wasn't one of those guys that would have to preach to you or bring up Bible verses, but he would share biblical principles all the time. I saw this in Hap in verses John 5 or 15, 13. It says, greater love than has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. And while Hap might not have died for the purpose of what he taught us, his sacrifice of love for each of us showed us the service of God in De Molay. You know, he worked hard each and every day. He'd work overtime. He'd work two or three different jobs. And you guys know when we lived there, it's like, hey, where are you going? I'm working at Loma Linda today. I'm doing this. And it's like, you know, he was single. He didn't have that family. But the reason he worked was because of his generosity. His generosity was absolutely amazing. So many times, you know, the big dinners that we went out to for jurisdictions and just a group together, we'd start digging in our pockets to pay for it, and they said, hey, it's been paid by Hap. For the first so many years that we would go out, especially with, guys, we're talking 20 to 30 at a very nice steak dinner place. We're looking at the menu going, ah! But he said it was on him. So we ordered more. No, we didn't. He opened his house to so many of us. Even some of you that crashed on his floor. He just cared about you so much. His love, he loved Christ just as he loved each and every one of our family members. And enjoyed his love as our dad. And for some of you that weren't associated with De Molay, we call our advisors Dad, Dad Arnold, Dad Hap, Dad Gary, Dad Cherno, whatever it might be. We calm down. There was a respect there. And the respect changed from just Dad Arnold to Hap, as you said. But more important, we call him Dad because of the love that he had for each and every one of us. He was Dad to me, Dad to my wife, Jennifer, a daughter. He loved you so much. And to my five daughters, he called the granddaughters. As you saw in some of those pictures, we don't use the word spoiled anymore. He loved them a great deal. Took them on different trips. Just always took care of them. Jennifer and I learned not to tell him what we were getting the girls for Christmas or their birthdays. Because we planned these things out and we would share with him what we were going to get and he would go out and buy it. And we would be scrambling around to figure out what we were going to get our kids for their birthdays or Christmas. Should have told him early enough that they all needed a car. I'm kidding. No, no. His love for me was so incredible. We all called him Dad, but he started calling me son. As Dennis was, I was talking about Dennis, he wanted a family to raise. And one day, like I said, he came and shared that he was going to adopt, and he loved Dennis and Nira Thomas so much. He did everything for those guys. He taught them life. And Dennis has really learned a lot of that life. I'm forever grateful for my brother Dennis. You know, he stepped out. Maybe he's in the cry room. But he was there for Hap when he really needed him. He needed him because he didn't call any of us to say, hey, I'm going through this stuff. He kept it all to himself, just as loved ones somehow do. We don't share some details with family or friends because we can make it through and we don't want to burden anybody else. But the support that he gave Hap through these last years, just absolutely incredible. He really stepped up and helped Hap during this difficult time of his health failing. Every time I talked to Hap on the phone, he would say, "Hey, I'm fine, I'm good, a little oxygen, I'm a little tired." I talked to him just a couple days before he passed away. And he said, I'm tired, I'm going to go get some rest. That night, Dennis took him in, and they put him in a rehab facility. But again, Dennis, he loved you more than life. So as we celebrate life today and the life that we have, his life was so intertwined with ours. I look at each and every one of you and know that he loved you and your friendship. How did a man love so many of us just like we were his own? Because he was dead. Matthew 5:4 says, "Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted." And I look at this verse and try to understand that verse. If you were close to Hap, we would ask, why would I even mourn? We mourn because it hurts. We're losing a part of our life. So it's obvious how he's touched your life. The Holy Spirit is what this verse says. Will comfort each and every one of you. And even today, we're among brothers and sisters to comfort each other. In Revelations 21:4, he says, "And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There shall be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There shall be no more pain, for the former things have passed away." While it's difficult and different when we lose someone here on earth, our hope has to be in God. In fact, 1 Thessalonians, let me open that, a couple of verses here, and I'll be ending. 1 Thessalonians says, "But I do not want you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning those who have fallen asleep, lest you sorrow as others who have no hope. For if you believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring him to those who sleep in Jesus." That's eternal life with Christ our Creator. But I take so much comfort in what John 14:1-3 says. If you open your bulletin right there, celebration of life, it's written right there for you. He says, "Let your," this is Jesus' word in my Bible, it's a red letter, it's right from Jesus' mouth. "Let not your heart be troubled, you who believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. But I go and prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also." In verse 4, it doesn't say it there, but I'm going to continue. "And where I go, you know, and the way you know." I take so much comfort in that verse, because not only does he say, "Let your heart not be troubled," he says, "I'm going to be with you. I'm going to take care of you. You believe in God, also believe in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would not have told you." He says, "I would not have said this if this wasn't the truth. I go and prepare a place for you." And this is the part that I love so much. He says, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you." In another verse, the Word of God says, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. I'm with you always. And so to me, I look at this verse right here, and in his last days of his breath, the Word of God clearly says, and this is for every one of our loved ones that we've passed, everyone that might pass in the future, rest assured in this verse. That Jesus says, if when I go, I'm going to come back and he's going to personally stand by your side and walk you through everything. And when you breathe your last, he takes you with him to be with the Creator in heaven. I can assure you that I've been praying for so many of you for so many years. Many years I've been praying for you. I want the best for you, and I want you to be in heaven with Hap. To give your life to Jesus Christ and ask him to be your Savior. Jesus loves you so much that he gave his life for you. John 11, 25 and 26 says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Then he says, do you believe this? Sometimes in our life, we have those doubts about religion, but this is a relationship with Jesus Christ, the Creator of everything. He says, I gave my life for each and every one of you. If you call upon my name, you'll be saved. You see, we only have a very few short years here on earth. 70, 80, 90, 100 years old. I'm fascinated by Saint, Mike, you and your father-in-law. He's 102. I'm fascinated by what you guys do and how you live life. 102 years old, this guy is dancing on the floors. But the thing is, there's going to be a day that we breathe our last. And so 100 years here on earth versus all eternity, forever and ever and ever and ever, that we will be together. The Word of God says heaven is greater. If you read through Revelations, heaven's greater than anything we can imagine. It says everything that we're working for, all of our money. He says the gold, the streets are going to be a pure gold that we're going to walk on. And we're laboring with our time here. Well, labor with your job and use your money to enjoy life. Happy, enjoyed life. Happy, enjoyed giving his money to others and loving them. I would ask you this because I don't want to hear from my friends that they passed away and me not knowing. That's the hardest thing is in my heart is not knowing if my friends and my family members have accepted Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, that they will be in heaven with us. Or John 14, 6 says, Jesus said to them, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. And provide his perfect direction for each of you. If you want to know more about Jesus Christ, call me, text me, Pastor Jim, Stacy, any one of us can help you and walk you through, answer questions. As some of you know, my sermons are on Facebook live at 9:55 every Sunday. Pastoring at Anchor Community Church. And I'm fascinated how many people watch me across the nation. Many of you watch and see and comment. I had no idea so many of you did. But I appreciate that each and every week, and you bring a smile to my face every time I see you on there. The thing about that, if you can go back and watch any of the sermons on my Facebook page, They're there for until Facebook says, hey, we don't like what you're saying and gets rid of me. But please do that. Please continue to share your memories with Hap, not with just us, but with other people as you continue to be the leaders that God's called you to be. So Hap, we're going to miss you, but your love and your memories and your bad sense of humor, your Hap jokes will always be with us. And yes, we know you are very proud of us. So God bless you guys. Thank you. I'm going to have Stacy come up and close us in prayer.
All right, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for letting us gather today to celebrate Hap and his life well lived. Thank you for blessing our lives with Hap, for the years we shared with him, for the love he gave us, and for all the wonderful memories that we'll always cherish. Thank you for making him who he was and giving him unlimited love to share with everyone he met. Let him know that we miss him, that we love him, and we will never forget the impact he had on our lives. I'm sure when he reached heaven, you greeted him with a hug and the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." Thank you for the promise of eternal life and the knowledge that we will see Hap again. Please keep all of us safe as we travel home and let us never forget Hap and the lessons that he taught us. In your heavenly name, amen.
Just in closing, to his roommates, I was his favorite. I say this with all my love for Hap. We all called him Dad, but he called me Son. We're going to miss him. God bless each and every one of you. Again, if you will have a... I'm sure the taco's ready, so we can go outside here and get your tacos and everything else that Brad's got over there. And there's room just to the side over here. Again, on behalf of Anchor Community Church, my church here, and more important, Hope Chapel here for all your help and everything else. And may God bless you guys.